Well, hello, lovely humans, and welcome back to my channel. If you are watching this on Wedding Chicks or over on Facebook, thank you so much for stopping by. This video has been so highly This video has been so highly requested, so I was really happy to finally sit down and put something together for you guys. Today we're going to be talking about your wedding I am on fire. Today we're going to be talking about your wedding day timeline. There are a couple things I need to address before I launch into this video. I have a very limited cultural experience when it comes to weddings. This is just what I normally do for the cultures that I normally plan. This may not apply to you. Like, for example, I know that in the UK, I think you guys serve two meals during your wedding day, if I'm not mistaken. Actually, surprise, surprise, this is super exciting. I haven't even talked about this yet. I am going over to England for a wedding next May, y'all, and I am so excited. So if you are one of my UK followers, comment down below what I should do, where I should go. My husband's coming along with me. We never had a chance to take our honeymoon, so we're actually like turning this into a vacation, which will be so cool. And you can bet your bottom dollar that I'm gonna be going to Brighton and I'm gonna be having myself a Zalfie day. We're gonna get Wagamama, we're gonna walk on the pier and all the stuff and all the things. But if you have recommendations for me, leave them on down below. So I know that there are different things that different cultures do on their wedding days or for their wedding weekend. Some festivities last for 3 to 4 days. That is not the kind of wedding that I normally plan, but I would love to have the opportunity to do so. I'm just saying, these are what I normally do for the style of weddings I normally plan. So with that disclaimer out of the way, if this doesn't apply to you, hopefully my stunning wit and over-caffeinated personality will be enough to keep you actively watching throughout the throughout the rest of this video. Because each and every wedding day is different, I'm gonna be using like chunks of time that you should be devoting to each activity instead of giving you like actual time. So hopefully you can take your ceremony start time and build up and build down from that start time. So without further ado, let's jump right on in. A typical wedding that I plan in the culture and in the area that I'm in is about 6 hours from start to finish. That tends to be like the sweet spot. That and most vendor packages are about 8 hours. So because you have those 8 hour packages, anytime you add on more time to your reception, that means you're either missing out on having that vendor present or you are paying extra for overtime for those people. So it's just something to kind of keep in mind. Because most packages are around 8 hours, you may be paying overtime if you decide to make your event longer than 6. When it comes to getting ready, if you are getting professional hair and makeup done, I normally defer to hair and makeup artists because they know how long they need. But for the sake of this video, let's just give you a time frame. Usually hair and makeup starts anywhere from 5 to 7 hours before your event starts. It depends on the amount of people getting their hair done, the amount of people getting their makeup done, if you're traveling for any of that. Your bridal party may be starting getting hair and makeup done at like 7 in the morning, or it could be as late as 10 or 11 in the morning. That just all, kind of all depends on your hair and makeup team. So again, I defer to them, but you might wanna plan anywhere from 5 to 7 hours beforehand. If you are doing a first look, I recommend doing that 2 hours before your event starts. That way you have plenty of time to get all of your portrait session done and your bridal party photos. Again, your photographer may want 2.5 or 3 hours beforehand, but I would leave that up to them. Usually 2 hours is a pretty good amount of time. And I should probably do an entire video on first looks because people are split on this one, y'all. Do you do it? Do you not do it? I'll get to that in another video, but I will say it does make your timeline a lot easier. And you'll find out why in just a little bit. If you are not doing a first look, you should put your dress on anywhere from 1 hour to 1.5 hours before your ceremony begins. That way your photographer has plenty of time to get portraits with you and your gals before you walk down the aisle. Also get all the detail shots of the dress being buttoned up or zipped up and all like the cutesy like posy photos. You'll also need to factor in travel time since you're probably getting ready somewhere offsite. Some places have bride rooms and groom rooms, but some don't. So keep that in mind. You may need to put your dress on a little bit earlier than 1.5 hours if you have a 20-minute travel time. I prefer to have the entire bridal party on site, ready to go, and hidden 30 minutes before the ceremony starts. And the reason that I do that is that's usually when the first guests start arriving. First people will show up 30 minutes before your event even begins, just because, you know, they're the early birds and they don't want to hit traffic and they want to make sure there's parking. Whatever the reasoning happens to be, 30 minutes beforehand is usually when we see the first guest show up. So we like to have y'all hidden so we don't spoil the surprise of you walking down the aisle in your beautiful dress. About 10 minutes before the ceremony starts is when I like to line up the family and the bridal party. Let's talk about ceremony start time, because this is another thing that people are so split on. Your invitation time is your ceremony start time. Now, some people might disagree with me, and that's okay. But for me, when I'm running an event, I like to be honoring of all of the people that are early and on time instead of waiting for the last five people to show up and pushing the ceremony by another 30 minutes. Does that make sense? Because then your first guest has been sitting there for an hour waiting for this to start. So I like to try to start as on time as possible. Now, of course, if traffic is stealing all of your guests, then we wait. We want to make sure the crowd is nice and full and ready for you to walk down the aisle. And if there's a very important person that's missing, you wait as well. However, I do not subscribe to the rule that you put a start time on your invitation and have a completely different start time on purpose, especially if that is like a 30-minute difference. 10 minutes, 15 minutes, those are totally fine. Happens all the time. We did a wedding this last weekend and we started, I think, 7 minutes late. So that was a pretty good one for us. But anything longer than 20 minutes, it's just really long for all of the guests that were good and showed up on time or even early. Now, when it comes to ceremony length, this can be anywhere from 15 minutes to an hour and a half in my planning experience. You may have something completely different. Your ceremony length may be 3 hours long. I'm not entirely sure. But be sure to devote enough time in your timeline to make that happen. After ceremony, you usually send all of your guests to cocktail hour. The only guest that you will not send would be your family. Your family will stay in the ceremony location and you'll spend about 20 minutes, maybe 30 minutes on doing family photos. And here's where a first look comes in handy, because if you've already done your first look, then you've already had a portrait session, which means it's just you and your spouse taking photos before the event. You've also already done bridal party photos because everyone's already there, so you don't need to worry about doing bridal party photos after the ceremony. If you haven't done a first look, you'll need to spend about 20 minutes doing bridal party photos. Then after that, you'll need to spend anywhere from 20 to 35 minutes doing a portrait session. Again, I like to defer to the photographers a little bit more on this. I never want to impede on their art. I just want to make sure that guests aren't waiting around for too long. About 15 minutes before your reception formally starts is when you should have guests being ushered into the space. Sometimes they didn't get a chance to take a look at the seating chart. Sometimes you have 200 guests and that takes a long time for them to move. So about 15 minutes before grand entrance, we will start ushering guests into the reception space to get them ready. During that time, you should also kind of be lining up for grand entrance and getting ready for go time. It also buys your photographer a little bit more time in case they didn't get all the photos that they want, so you can kind of push your grand entrance 15 minutes later if you need to. And then you have your grand entrance. This can be with your full bridal party, it could be just you as a couple, but it does create a nice bookend or starter for your reception, and it kind of sets the tone. Here's where we have another option. Some people will go grand entrance straight into first dance. Totally fine, nothing wrong with that. Some people prefer, like me and my husband, we actually chose to go straight to dinner instead because I know when he gets hangry, he is not a happy person to be around. So if you want to, you can either have first dance here or go straight to dinner. Depending on the type of dinner service and the amount of guests you have, dinner can take anywhere from 45 minutes to an hour and a half. Anything longer than an hour and a half and you could get yourself some pretty bored or pretty disgruntled guests, because that means it's an hour and a half from the first plate to the last plate. So that first person has been sitting there for an hour with nothing to do. So try to keep that in mind. Ask your caterer about their service times, let them know the amount of guests that you have, so you can better allocate time for how long dinner's gonna take. After that comes the toasts. What I like to do with toasts is usually after the last table sits down, if you're doing buffet style, or the last table is served, if you're doing plated, I give them about 5, 7, 10 minutes to kind of chow down a little bit, and then we start the toasts, because they can still be discreetly eating while we're making sure we keep the energy nice and moving. That way, nothing ever feels like it's dull or there's a lag or there's like a break in the event, you know what I mean? So we start toasts usually 5 to 10 minutes after the last plate has been served. For toasts, we recommend no more than 5. However, it's your wedding day, you can do whatever the heck you want. If you want to have 17, go for it. Just bear in mind that guests could get a little bit bored or antsy while waiting through all of those. Little side tip, when you are asking people to give toasts, tell them they have 2 to 3 minutes and plan on them taking 5. So let's say if you had 4 people giving toasts, you'd plan about 20 minutes for that. even though you told them they only get 2 to 3, you may get one person who's nervous and then starts rambling, like, starts saying all these words and gets really awkward. Like, I don't know anybody who would do that. After toasts, if you haven't done your first dance already, this is the perfect opportunity to do that. Then, usually after that, you have your perfunctory family dances, which would be father-daughter and mother-son. For you, this may mean brother-sister dance, or it could be mother-daughter dance. You've got a bunch of different options here, but that's usually where you'd place those two items. Again, those usually aren't longer than 2, maybe 2.5 minutes, but you plan for about 5 on your timeline. It just gives you a nice buffer in case someone talks too long, or in case your event starts a little bit later. You have all of that great wiggle room. And then you jump into open dancing. There are a couple different ways that you can do this as well. I feel like I'm like making sure you know that none of this is set in stone. You've got options. You don't have to do everything I'm telling you to do. Just like know that. But you asked for it, so I'm giving you suggestions. Usually when it comes to open dancing, I like to give guests anywhere from 45 minutes to an hour of just straight fun open dancing before you jump into any of the other things that you want to check off your list. The reason that I like to do that is because a DJ works very hard to get your dance floor moving. And if you have it moving for about 15 minutes and then you kill the vibe, there goes all of his or her hard work. So my suggestion to you would be give him about 45 minutes to an hour of open dancing, let him or her build up that dance floor, let guests really enjoy that experience, and then you can jump into cake cutting, bouquet toss, and garter toss. Again, those don't take a super long time, but I allot about 5 minutes for each of them. The difference here is if you are not doing bouquet toss or garter toss, I would recommend actually putting your cake cutting near the parent dances or like near the family dances. And here's why. If you're gonna pull all of your guests' attention away from the dance floor, you wanna make it worth their while. You wanna stick a couple things back to back. So it provides them a nice break if they've been getting their boogie on. And two, it doesn't feel like, okay, cake cutting. Okay, back to dancing. You know what I mean? So if you are not doing any of those other perfunctory things, smush cake cutting up in the beginning of the reception instead of stopping the dance floor when a DJ's been working so hard to make sure that that vibe is spot on. Last call usually happens about 15 to 30 minutes before your event's supposed to end. Usually the catering company or the bar service will tell you what time that needs to be, or sometimes even the venue will as well. And then about 10 minutes before you're ready to leave, your guests will line up for your grand exit. Even if you're doing like a third grade soccer tunnel, have them line up early. And then that's the end of your evening. So that's basically in a nutshell what your day of timeline could look like. Again, if this doesn't fit your overall wedding style, or if there's things that you want to adjust, go for it. The reason that we create day of timelines is because we want everything to feel like it flows seamlessly from one event to the next. We never want you or your guests to feel bored or antsy or feel like, oh my goodness, this is taking forever. Why? These times that I've given you are not, they're not set in stone. But they're just times that I have found that keeps a really good natural cadence throughout your day. Again, these are only for the weddings that I usually plan, and I'd love to have an experience with something that's way longer or way different. So if you do something different in your culture or in your country, comment that down below, because I would love to hear about all the different wedding cultures that we have out there. I feel like I'm still so blown away that I have people watching this on the other side of the world. Like, that just blows my mind. So I'm still learning so much about the wedding community. I still only know so little. Help me out. Educate me down below. And like I've been saying in my last several videos, I'm recording this on Monday, but it's gonna go up on Tuesday. I'm pretty sure today's the day that we hit 10K. What the heck? Oh, this is so surreal. It's so exciting. I'm so excited. If you haven't done so already, subscribe, like, for more tips and tricks for the modern day bride, and, you know, just so I can like freak out some more. Details for the giveaway, like I've said, last few videos, are going to be on our Instagram once we hit 10K. So if you're not following me there, do that. Because you don't want to miss out, because I feel like it's a pretty darn good giveaway. I'm just saying. You can always tell when I've spent the morning binge watching makeup videos on YouTube. This morning it was Chelsea Roach, who actually did like a makeup tutorial on my channel a couple months back. So I'm gonna link her down below, because y'all, she doesn't just show you how to do makeup, she like tells you all of these rad tricks, and Lord knows I would not know how to apply false lashes if it weren't for that girl. I'll link that video specifically down below too, because it'll change your life. As always, a huge shout out to my gal pals over at Wedding Chicks for hosting this video, and until next week, bye guys. Stop. Looks like I'm wearing a nightie. I'm not. It's $3. How could I not spend $3 on a top? I mean, it was like, buy me. I was like, okay.